Hello. I hope you're doing well today. Welcome to my stream. All right, I'll stop being rude. I have to finish. I have to co post one more thing on Discord to let people know that I'm live. But I hope everyone's doing well today. I'm excited to hang out. Yeah, I feel like it's been a while, even though a lot of us just talked on Sunday. Thank you, Dechibron. I'm glad you like the hot pink. Yeah, today I was like, I don't feel as good. My tummy's kind of being a butt, so let's do something different. But I also kind of feel like I look at my face today and I'm like, look a different person. I don't know who this is that I'm looking at, but it looks like a different person. One second, I just need to tell people that I am live. One second. There we go. Okay, finished that. Okay, so today, how's everybody doing? I hope you're all doing well. I really enjoyed this Sunday's Twitch stream. If you didn't get a chance to check it out, I really recommend it. I was talking with this really cool person, Elmira. Hello, Silly Mylethiel. And Elmira got her PhD in basically studying fan fiction and was looking at, hi, cute Pody, looking at sort of consent in fan fiction. And we talked about their research, their like what got them into doing fan studies, and then also sort of consent in video games and sort of all these other related things. And it was actually just like a really fun conversation. And then today we're gonna play some more Stardew Valley. I don't know if we'll read as much as we have recently, because I said, like I mentioned, I feel my stomach's not as happy as I would like it to be. So I figured we can kind of just chill out and talk about like how different types of setups of communities would assist with things like consent, which we've talked about before, but also about things like social services and like helping people. And is there any hope for Shane? That's my big question is like people like Shane, it's not an issue of like his willpower and like his desire to sort of deal with his alcoholism and his potential mental health issues. It seems like he's in a bad way a lot of the time. It's a community thing and it's a social and structural level thing. So anyway, I wanted to start today with this post here. It's a Facebook post that I saved from a little while back, and I wanted to talk about, because we're going to talk about some different types of architecture and different ways that architecture affects senses of place and affects sort of like human connection and human interaction. And so I figured I'd start with actually a critique of some very popular, very common infrastructure or infrastructure architecture. There's this cute picture here of, now that's what I call architecture, and it's a picture of probably a kind of development you've probably seen, where you have here this, it is mixed use. There is a nice sidewalk space on the front, and it's does not necessarily, like not fit a lot of the things we want, right? Some of the things we've talked about previously that are things that really facilitate healthier communities and hi Barontor, hi Krellin. Okay, Krellin, you asked, do you think people would like Shane less if it wasn't known that he could be fixed? Yes, I absolutely think they would like Shane left. Less, not left. I personally think there's a lot of cute things about Shane. I love the way he likes chickens a lot, and if you marry him, he gets a chicken and he just becomes a chicken farmer, and it's very cute. And I think that George Martin is to blame for everything. I think that continuing to drink excessively admired. I haven't gotten that far, so I'm not sure. But he does say at one point that he's going to stop drinking and is going to drink only water. And if you find him at the bar and you question him, he'll say that it's just like a Joja Cola or something that he's drinking. Yeah, and I think that, like, the world's not offering him very much, and that's part of the problem. He's not really being supported in a lot of really important ways. But anyway, this architecture here. So we have this kind of new development that's pretty common, right? Where it is mixed use on the bottom. It is denser, and for sure it tries to be as dense as it can. And it's not very tall. And we'll get into some of the reasons for that. The person who made this post made a really good, well evidenced, well researched sort of discussion of what is going on with this kind of architecture. And it's one of those things where it does fit some of the things we've been talking about that would be nicer if we had things that could be really helpful to creating more human scale, more livable, more community oriented communities, right? Like this one's nice. It's got all these balconies and it's nice to have your own terrace, and there is green here, and it's probably pretty walkable, and this might have a gym in it, and like there's lots of nice things, and there's some problems with this kind of architecture. So I want to talk about it. I'm going to read this post out loud. I've shortened everything so that protecting people's identity as much as possible. But the original poster is this Gillian McDaniel. I want to give this person credit. And they say that it's called 5-over-1 construction. And there's a reason you see it everywhere and a reason everyone hates it. It's called a podium building. The 5-over-1 refers to five floors of wooden framed construction over a concrete base, with the ground floor typically reserved for parking, retail, or resident amenities. It's the cheapest way to build apartments in the US under the International Building Code, which allows for up to five stories of wood frame construction. These buildings further minimize the cost by using easily installed flat windows, fiber cement facade coverings called hardy panels, and a process called rain screen cladding to protect the wood frame from water damage. So it's not, I don't want to give this impression that wood frame buildings are in any way like bad or cannot last, right? Like there are, even in Vienna, like half timbered buildings that are hundreds and hundreds of years old that people still live in. I know that there are places in England as well and France. I'm sure all over Europe this exists, where they are fundamentally wood buildings with a stone foundation often, but not always, that are still in continuous use and have been well maintained. And one of the things to just start with, though, is most of these buildings that are really well maintained, that are still functioning in this way, are ones where, a lot of time was taken to do things like prepare the ground, and a lot of effort went into consistent maintenance, and they were designed. The ones that have lasted, there's a kind of survivorship bias in them. The ones that have lasted were things that either sometimes they got lucky when where they were built, there wasn't too many disturbances or fires, or the ground was really stable, but also that, they, generally speaking, were built really well, really high quality building. And most of our houses are made out of wood still, right? Like single family houses are usually still made out of wood, even duplexes. And they can last, right? Like I'm not saying that wood buildings are bad, but the more stress you're putting on it, and the faster you build it, and the less time you spend preparing the ground, and the fewer protections you have for the wood itself, the more risk. So, use of standard building materials and processes creates a recognizable aesthetic that is often wildly unpopular. Many describe it as bland, devoid of architectural detail, and an eyesore in cities known for ornate and historic building styles. This definitely, where I lived in the south of France for a long time, it was really beautiful city center, really, these lovely old buildings, and this like charm, and sort of everything was really mixed use and dense. And then in the sort of just outside of the city center, there was a lot of these types of buildings. And it was interesting because there were people who wanted to live, and this is also true in Vienna, we see these things. People who wanted to live in them because they liked the new buildings. They felt like it was more modern, it was newer. And I think that's reasonable, right? Like, not everybody likes the way the old ones look. You know, my place here, my ceilings are like almost 4 meters high. It's like 3.6 meters. So that's almost 15 feet, I think. And it's more expensive to heat a place like this. You know, the windows have been replaced, so there's not a ton of temperature leakage from them like there could be in windows that hadn't been more recently replaced. But it also has more like echo, and I don't know, there are other things. I really am partial to these older buildings, so I'm not sure what everyone doesn't like about them. Maybe it's like you can't mount quite as much stuff on the walls because there's not going to be like studs inside. But I'm not sure. Anyway, cute Pody, you said my hometown has a timber frame building from the 16th century, I think. Yeah, I mean it's not that uncommon to find this kind of thing. And the thing is, though, I will say with a lot of buildings, you can put on facades, right? Like, it just because the buildings are ugly now does not mean they're going to be ugly forever. You can put facades on and do beautification. I think you're right, Tiburon. There are, yeah, my building, we don't have HVAC. We have, it's gas heating, so it's like copper pipes everywhere. And we don't have an elevator, but a lot of old buildings in Vienna have elevators installed. Usually you have this sort of center courtyard area that is like usually for light. And my building has two of them. No, three. There's like this one here that's got a tree in it, and then there's two kind of over there. One's where we have all of our garbage, and one is just for light. And a lot of the time, if people want to add in an elevator after the fact, if depending on how the building is set up, you could put it in one of those spaces, and then people just go into that little courtyard, and then there's an elevator to go up. My building, I think, could reasonably do that, except for maybe the absolute top floor. We could stop one below it. But it's often a desire of things like the residents. But yeah, elevators, definitely, it can be a big accessibility issue. You know, I think about sometimes, like, what if I broke my leg or something? I'm on the fifth floor. That would be difficult. But one of my legs would get, like, really buff, probably. Anyway. So it's not, I'm not going to say that like my critique of these kinds of buildings is because I don't like the way they look. You know, aesthetics and aesthetic sensibilities come and go and they change. And you know, I know something in Vienna, there's a ton of public housing. I'm blanking on the amount, but actually an incredibly high amount, and all new building projects need to include some amount of housing set aside for, hi, Paladin Hulk. Yeah, concrete cubes will make a comeback. Anyway, there are all of these buildings that they're not very beautiful to look at in terms of like aesthetics. Like, I live in this like sort of Art Nouveau kind of building. The area that I live in has a lot of these Art Nouveau buildings. It's one of the things I really like about it because they're quite beautiful and they have like statues on the outside and stuff, and it's just kind of, I don't know, ridiculously pretty. But anyway, you know, there are these public housing works, most of them that were built in the like 30s to the 50s in Vienna, and they're not very beautiful to look at, but I find them beautiful in the sense of like, this is like a social safety net. This is like an example of the city thinking about the health and well-being of the people who live here and making active choices to make sure that more housing is available. It's never enough. And like, I do have friends who are like, I wish I could live in a place that were cheaper. I'm in a very like subsidized apartment. I'm paying like 200 a month, and even that can be hard. And like, absolutely. It's, you know, housing is a human right, so we should market solutions to things like that tend to be difficult, and even the subsidization can't go far enough a lot of the time. Anyway, let's just continue. These concerns are not unfounded. The blocky and homogeneous structures can be a jarring visual contrast to the established cityscape. So remember, the one critique I do have here is when we were talking about the sort of research on self sense of place, buildings and the way buildings look actually have a huge impact on people's sense of connection to the place that they're in, their sense of well-being there, the sort of, sense of being welcomed by a place. So these things can be important. It's rough, when all the buildings have these nice like pass-throughs, for example, where it's like, oh, there's this big street and I would have to go way far around and go over, but there's this nice courtyard pass-through and it's nice and lovely inside and it's all fenced off and I'm not allowed to go through there. I understand the reasons for doing that kind of thing and it's frustrating. Yes, there is a Yeah, so it was also the Jugendstil. For all the German speakers, I'm sorry. The Art Nouveau, the session I think was this particular like group of people, and but they also call it Jugendstil here. And I'm sorry for my German pronunciation. And brutalism, I don't totally dislike brutalism. Like that's definitely, and I think sometimes like a really beautiful, ostentatious, like Baroque building contrasted with like a concrete brutalist monstrosity can be a really fun, interesting contrast. And you can think about sort of like, I don't know, what was happening in the world at the time? What are the differences in like individual person's power between one of these buildings' histories and the other one building's history? And like, I don't know, there's actually Karlsplatz in Vienna is this like, has this really, really beautiful cathedral church. I don't know, something gorgeous. And next to it is this really hideous kind of brutalist building. And it's kind of fun sometimes to sit there and look at the two of them. But these aesthetics are tough, right? Because everybody's got what they like, everybody's got the things that connect with them emotionally. And a lot of the time, it's not something that's like very logic founded, right? Like people can have arguments for why one aesthetic is more pleasing than the other, but a lot of the time it really like, and there can be influences of things like say classism and all of that. But a lot of the time it's just you like what you like. It's like everybody thinks X celebrity is incredibly attractive, and for me I'm just like, I don't know. It doesn't do it for me. And some of those things, like I said, can be like socially mediated, and some of it's just you like what you like. Anyway, having a sense of being welcomed by the architecture creates these sorts of landscapes. There's all this stuff that's in like, I don't really like it, evolutionary psychology that likes to have all these stories about like what is the true evolutionary nature of beauty and like the things that we find beautiful, they propose were things like landscapes that were more likely to be temperate and not very cold in the winter and had fruit and stuff like that because we like these meandering rivers and mountains and stuff. And I'm like, to me that takes it way too far. But things like how many trees there are in a city, we do have pretty good evidence to say that the fewer trees that you interact with, the more likely you are to, not feel as happy about your life or also just have asthma or like effects from pollution. Yeah, I would agree, Dichebron. I would not say that brutalism is aesthetically pleasing. I have seen some brutalist architecture that I was like, actually, this does something for me, especially in some very sort of desolate landscapes where it's a work of art rather than I would think like a thing that we're actually meant to live in or work in and interact with in those ways. When I view it just as like this art piece in certain types of landscapes, certain types of photography of it can be really interesting. But yeah. Anyway, if you lived in or toured one of more than one of these buildings, you'll quickly see a pattern in how apartments are laid out. Shapes and square footage of apartments are selected to maximize rentable space. These buildings use the cheapest, safe, and legal construction methods and optimize for space. Because they're primarily built in urban areas zoned for multifamily housing, they could provide an answer to an ongoing housing crisis in these areas. The cheap construction could translate to savings for renters and improve low-income housing availability, right? So the thing is, this is one of those things that people often make this argument. It's like, don't be too critical of it. We just need to build as much housing as fast as possible. But I also always try to think about future people and future energy surpluses. Like right now, as we've talked about previously, we have a pretty good energy surplus. And what I mean by that is that we have enough energy to physical energy. I'm not talking about like mental and emotional energy. I'm talking about like the actual energy to make things and build things and change the physical landscape around us. We have this cheap energy surplus right now, but we don't have a guarantee that we'll have that in the future. If we continue with most of our energy needs being given to us through fossil fuels, we will definitely run out if we cannot sort of develop other technologies. But even then, it's unclear if we could come up with technologies that would continue to provide the kind of energy surplus that we have at this moment. Moreover, most things like most of the world's old growth forests have already been clear cut. And so you think about like shops like IKEA, right? Like they're cheap furniture. I mean, they're still actually pretty expensive for what you're getting, but those things aren't going to last, right? Some stuff at IKEA is fine. For sure. But some things, you build it once and it's fine. But if you take it down and rebuild it, especially if you take it down and rebuild it more than once, it quickly starts to lose a lot of its integrity and it doesn't tend to hold up to a lot of wear and tear. And things tend to break. And part of that is the fact that a lot of the trees that are being used in the wood to build a lot of the wooden furniture that they have is stuff that has been selected or developed in order to grow as fast as possible because we need more wood. The wood demand that we have, like the forests that are going to have this really dense, really healthy, really strong wood, cannot grow at pace for our demand, right? We've used up most of it. And so we've kind of like hiding the fact that a lot of the manufacturing materials we have, the quality of them is severely degraded. And it's also why you get a lot more furniture that's made from like pulped wood, like medium density fiberboard and other similar things, because you can kind of hide through uses of fillers and glues and other things the fact that we just don't have a lot of these as many raw materials anymore. Or like a lot of IKEA shelves and tables and such, if you actually cut them in half, the inside is cardboard in it. And it's structurally pretty good. And as long as you're gentle with it, it will last. But it's hard to guarantee that. So I bring up this like IKEA example because you can imagine the cheapest and fastest construction methods can be good, but it is unlikely that they are going to last as long as, say, these old half-timbered buildings that were made from these really old, strong pieces of wood that were had the ground well prepared, things were maintained. Those sorts of techniques. So I try to think about like this could be a temporary solution, but what happens when these buildings fall apart? And a lot of the time, they're not really designed to be able to be maintained very well. They kind of are flimsy inside. The construction materials are not very good. And if something like the ground shifts over time, which a lot of ground does, the foundations are not such that you can usually readjust them very well, right? Like one of my childhood homes, we were on this sort of hill, and this area in the backyard had been a pond at one point, and it had kind of shrunk down over time to this like little stream. But the ground was pretty soft, and the house kind of tilted and sit shifted over the. It was several hundred years old. It was like a almost 300-year-old building. Because I grew up in Massachusetts, so it was full of old buildings, and we had this kind of technology for the way that the house was put on top of the foundation that used things like joist beams. You don't really see those as much in modern technology or modern construction of buildings. But because of how they were made, if one piece of wood rotted out, or say like termites got to it, you could easily take that part of the sort of foundation of the house out and put in a new one. But you could also use them to help re-level the house. And it was really easy to sort of keep the stability and integrity of the house maintained because of the kind of technology that was used. A little bit of a digression. Just thinking about it. So what they're saying here is this cheap construction. Yeah, and cute Pody. Exactly. It's very hard with this IKEA stuff because a lot of us do have to move so often. And we I'm like, I have this bed over here that I got used from a friend. They were moving. I wanted a guest bed. They were moving to a smaller apartment. They couldn't fit it because it's like a queen size bed. And I was like, this will be great when like my mom comes to visit and stuff, that she can have this bed. And we rebuilt it together, and we really did our best to like perfectly align everything and make sure everything was perfectly tight. And it's rickety. And this is just one deconstruction and reconstruction. And we did not do it rushed. We did not do it in a shoddy manner. We did it as precise as we could. And there are some things we can do. Like I have some L bracket type things that I can use to kind of reinforce the structure itself. But that's only going to do so much, right? I will definitely do that before I have my parents sleep on this bed because it's kind of rickety and I don't want them to feel weird. But, and you know, it was great because I basically got it for nothing from a friend who was like, I just can't use this anymore. So it's, I'm not complaining too much. And it does mean though that eventually all that wood is gonna just be in a trash heap, right? It's not the kind of thing where like 200 years from now, I can put it up on a secondhand website and be like, look at this antique, you know, beautiful bed from the, you know, early 2020s. Doesn't everybody love it? Right. But like, I can see that with a lot of stuff, furniture on the secondhand websites here, stuff that's hundreds of years old and is like still functional. Anyway, continuing. Five over one buildings are marketed as luxury apartments. Unit interiors are designed to feel high-end, with features like laminate flooring and solid surface countertops that imitate their higher quality counterparts. The atmosphere of luxury is compounded with opulent amenities like resort-style pools, resident lounges, and co-working spaces, and on-site gyms. They offer cordial perks like free coffee and social events for residents while simultaneously cutting essential corners to comfortable living. Modern light fixtures are fit with the cheapest bulbs on the market, which go out within 2 weeks of move-in and require replacement by the resident. Showers are set to provide low water pressure and a lukewarm high temperature. Garbage disposals and drains are frequently clogged. Electrical outlets are disabled, sinks leak, faucets break. Most importantly, apartments are not built with a reasonable expectation of resident privacy. Non-disruptive activities like vacuuming, walking in shoes, and playing ambient music can be heard through floors and walls. Residents are forced into a state of constant caution out of respect to their neighbors, further compounded by large numbers of people working from home. Accompanying this manufactured affluence is a price tag not rooted in reality. Rent for these properties varies by city, but almost always exceeds the minimum wage monthly take-home pay of $1,150. No concessions for affordable housing are offered. In my current city, $1,500 is on the low end of normal for one, sorry, for a one-bedroom apartment in an urban-zoned five over one building. To afford this apartment, a person looking to spend 30% of their income on rent would need to bring home $4,500 a month in take-home pay, four times the minimum wage. Yeah, like I didn't even make this. They're like my whole month. Anyway, yeah. So, compounding exorbitant base rents, rent increases 3 to 5% every year. Residents are almost never rewarded or renewed at their current rate and are forced to pay this premium to maintain their current housing. To put this in perspective, the federal minimum wage has not increased since 2009. Fast casual architecture does nothing to solve the urban housing crisis. It prioritizes profit over people while masquerading as affluence. It enables gentrification. It blends the unique appearances of U.S. cities into an amorphous and sterilized blob. It insults the profession of architecture with flat and generic non-design disguised as modernism. Okay, so some of the points here, like, definitely it's not sort of respecting the things that architecture can do. And I'm not talking about architecture in like this sort of ostentatious, like look at the sort of like power we have to create extreme beauty or anything. Like sometimes I walk around and look at all, like there's so many palaces in the city and they're beautiful. But I also, when I look at them, I think about how many people were like starving so that that building could be built, right? Because like for the nobility to have that kind of money and to just like make like 50,000 palaces and like give them to their friends and stuff, it's like, And I can appreciate their beauty, but also to me, it's always tinged with this like, what was the horror that we didn't see that was behind or created by this creation? So I have mixed feelings about all of them. And the other thing is, so I think that that is not what I'm saying here when I'm when we're talking about things like not really respecting architecture. It's more this idea that it's not a paying attention to or giving consideration for the ways that architecture affects things like our mental health and our sense of well-being and our sense of connection to each other. You know, the spaces that we build around us are important to us and affect our sense of self and our psyche. And we don't have to make them hideous. We don't have to make them like ridiculous luxury ostentation, but we can care about them and they can be important to us. Okay. The other thing is, as it says here, they're expensive and they're not going to be built to last. So this is an example of what I talk about with like extractive technologies of like sort of how we even do property, right? Because like you go into a place, you build this architecture, you get as much money out of the people there as you can, while you can, for as cheaply as possible. And then once the building has started to really fall apart, you can wash your hands of it and you don't have to do things to maintain it, especially if it's condos. And because those are then owned by people and then they're on the hook for this, right? Like my first apartment that I lived in Seattle, I was very lucky because my partner's aunt had bought it when she first moved to Seattle, and that's where she had lived for a while. And then she kept it to rent it out and we were able to rent it from her. We paid market rent for it. We weren't being given some huge discount or anything. So it's still very expensive. But because it was a condominium building, because it had been apartments originally, it was built in the 50s. So it wasn't built like completely terribly. But when things like the elevators went out, it would be like there was one thing that went wrong and it was requiring basically every owner to put up 20 grand to fix certain things. And a lot of people didn't have that. But because of the sort of a condominium agreement, they were basically legally on the hook for this because they needed to take out a loan to do these major repairs to the building. And so this is what I'm talking about when I say like, this one example is an example of the risk that everybody gets put at when we do these kind of shoddy buildings, because we have to live somewhere and there's not always going to be nice new places to move into. So, and we're not always going to have the energy surplus to make nice new places quickly and cheaply. And cheaply, I don't mean using cheap materials like here. I mean like cheaply as in it's not going to cost us so, so much because energy is more expensive. So then, I don't know, we're just really like setting ourselves up for shit time. That's all I'm trying to say. We should be thoughtful about this. Okay, so I have a different article I want to read. I'm going to readjust the size of this. Give me just a second because I modified my Facebook window to protect privacy of people on my Facebook, just in case like someone sent me a Facebook message or something. So I got to readjust this. Just give me a moment. And also this website tiny bit annoying because there's no scroll bar at the bottom, so I can't scroll away from this huge side here. Anyway, I digress. It's fine. This one is pretty cool. I'm gonna zoom in. Maybe that'll be slightly nicer. We'll see. We'll see. Nope, wrong button. Wrong button. Okay, this is good enough. So here we have this article. It is from, let me actually fix this a little bit. From this website called Social Life, and it is their research. And they have this picture of one of these more modern buildings that we were just kind of talking about. There is like an e-bike station or like a bike sharing thing here. These kinds of bike sharing programs I actually like a lot, especially when they're owned by the city. Like in Vienna, we have City Bike, and it's cute because there's newsletters and you can get like points for if you take bikes from like low elevations and bring them up to the higher elevation stations and stuff like that. Because they do have a tendency to kind of pool away from or downhill. That kind of always happens with any of these things. And but having docking stations helps with that. And this can be really nice because not everybody needs to have their own bike or could really have a place to put them or anything, and sharing the cost is nice. Nice big sidewalk, I like that. There's a little kind of cafe down here. There's some outside table space. I don't totally love being like this close to a road when I'm eating my food and such. And there are no trees, so it's kind of meh. But otherwise, I was like, yeah, okay. So let's read this article, and it's called Thinking About the Human Scale. So, central London is transforming with more and more construction and newly opened office towers. As monolithic buildings increasingly shape our streetscapes, we need to think about what it means to build places for people. Recent studies have shown that architectonic superstructures of glass and steel impact on our well-being and risk creating an experience of isolation. And they have a footnote here that we can look at the end what their sources are. Some of the new built glass towers do not only stray away from the human scale in their size, but also in their accessibility. Glass facades may provide a visual opening between inside and outside, but locked doors, porters, and empty entrances exclude the life on the street. So this is an example that they're like, do you feel welcomed by this? Yeah, the glass lets you look inside, but are you actually welcomed here? Are you being invited in? And also, a lot of these buildings are like really bad for birds, and little birds die because they like bump into them because there and there is glass technology where you can do this like tiny little dots inside the glass or some other patterns that won't really be that noticeable to you, but really help birds not crash into things and people don't use them as much because they're expensive. Anyway. glass facades may provide a visual opening between the inside and outside, but locked doors, porters, and empty entrances exclude the life on the street. So you got this contrast here, right? Obviously, there's a little bit of like a clear idea here because this is very gray and this is very colorful comparatively. It's a lot warmer. There's color here, and they're contrasting them. And they're not that different in the sense that they're both along streets, right? They're both next to sort of mixed use places. One's got plants, one's got outdoor seating space that seems to be open, though it might be some sort of like rope here, sort of sectioning off the space. Like maybe this is for an event, or you have to be a patron of this cafe or whatever to be here. But there's a different feeling. So let's read more. We all perceive the world around us differently, influenced by our bodies, our history, and social relations. The human scale cannot be understood as an objective measure of physical space. The US-based Project for Public Spaces have worked with the notion the human scale is in different contexts, and their definition separates this from the height or materials of a specific building. For the Project for Public Spaces, the human scale is about the community and social activities. So this is, I think, I really like this point because a lot of the time when we hear human scale, One that doesn't necessarily give us a good idea of what we're talking about, but then it doesn't just mean that like everything is similar scales to what we would find, quote unquote, in nature, because the things we build are still part of nature. We're still in nature. This building is nature. Like, it's just the things that human animals build. And I have cats that live here, and there are plenty of spiders and ants and other living things that also share this place with me. Okay, I'm digressing again. The human scale in any given community depends upon what the community perceives as human scale. And it's got this source here, and it's placemaking in the human scale city. And we can. I've got this link open in another tab, so we can talk about it another time. When the architecture of new building closes itself from the streets, it risks creating dead zones in existing neighborhoods. Instead of adding to the local buzz, they remove the street life. So here, I think we can see this, right? Like this first one is very closed off. It's very much this idea that like there's the sidewalk is for moving and moving along. And there is a place inside here to linger, but it doesn't feel very sort of inviting. This doesn't feel like, even though the sidewalk is this sort of public space, if you just like sat down and started playing Monopoly here with your friends, the person, like the security of this building might come out and tell you to move along, right? Or, it doesn't feel like this place is really going to be used for the activities of this community. It's just. There's a little bit of outdoor cafe seating and people walk along through. It looks like maybe there's like an ATM or something over here. So there are some things that people can use, but it doesn't seem like this is space for you to use to fulfill the needs that you can have as a person. Versus this here, even if this is sort of this rope here is not just decoration, it's sort of separating things off. That's not necessarily bad because it's not like a hard barrier. It might just kind of be to try to help people from not like cycling into it or bumping into people or whatever. But this space does seem like it can be used, right? There are people sitting on the ground, there are beanbag chairs, there are like outdoor metal chairs, there's color, there's decoration. We can see there's other people back here, and this is not perfect. I'm not saying like this is necessarily exactly the thing we should always aim for, but this sidewalk space does feel like it is meant for people. It's meant to be used. It's a place that is public and is actually accessible to the public to use it how it wants to. Obviously, there's still the normal rules of society. You can just like take a poo here. People would be upset about that. But like there is this idea that it is more public and it's more something that we actually get to own together and have access to. And let's continue. Let me see, maybe, did I skip anything? Okay. When the architecture of new buildings closes itself off from the streets, it risks creating dead zones in existing neighborhoods. So I think that the other point I want to add here, because I forgot about this, is like think about in neighborhoods you've either walked through or lived in or seen, how you can have these like quote unquote public spaces that are supposed to be shared, but they're always kind of empty. Nobody uses them. A lot of sort of like street corners or the ends of a street, if it's a sort of end, dead end, or like, sort of like public square or something. There's no life to them, really. People aren't really using them. And a lot of the time, the people who then do use them get kicked out, like homeless people who are like, okay, I'm going to stay here. And there's not likely to be benches, partially because of an anti-homeless thing, because heaven forbid somebody doesn't want to sleep on the super cold concrete that's going to suck out all their body heat and wants to get off of that. Oh no, you can't sleep on the. Anyway. People remove park benches because we don't care about human life. Instead of adding to the local buzz, they remove the street life. Danish urbanist Jan Gehl has observed that people walk faster in front of a blank facade to avoid the unpleasant monotony of the street. Similarly, neuroscientist and radical geographer Colin Ellard has found that streets with no game increase sadness, addiction, and disease-related stress. I would want to look at the evidence here, but I also wouldn't be surprised, right? There have been good studies like on rats. Rats aren't people. I don't necessarily love things like rat studies to explain human nature, but we've done studies where we take rats and we put them in like very sterile cages, and we give them different waters that some have are just plain water, some have sugar water, some have like heroin in it, and the rats tend to become incredibly addicted to either the sugar or the heroin, and don't want to do anything else because they're in basically rat hell. There's nothing to do. But if we put them in rat paradise where they have all the things they like to do and they can socialize and there's novel, interesting things and there's comforts and there's play stuff, they don't care about the heroin water. They won't. So there is evidence that I already know of for this, but to me, this feels like a big list to just go and say streets that are sad looking increase sadness, addiction, and disease-related stress. But it could be true. Okay, so continuing, not only are people more likely to walk around in cityscapes with open and lively facades, but the kind of things that they do in such places actually change. They pause, look around, and absorb their surroundings while in a pleasant state of positive affect and with a lively, attentive nervous system. So this is a neuroscientist saying this, but I do think that this is an example of that sort of sense of place. Do you feel invited to linger by the ways in which the world around you has been created? Do you feel like you're actually allowed to just be there? One of the common complaints I have about a lot of the world, but especially in America, is that there aren't that many places you can just go without being expected to spend money. There's the library, and then there are public parks, and pretty much everywhere else, if you want to go and be outside of your home or someone else's home, you're expected to spend a lot of money, and it's often really isolating if you don't have that money. And then the other problem can happen if there's not good public infrastructure and your friends live too far away and it's going to take you 3 bus transfers and 4 hours to get there. Are you going to go? Probably not that often. So these things definitely increase the sense of loneliness. But if you feel like you're invited to stay and linger, you're also more likely to actually learn about the place that you're living in, recognize when things change. Remember in the research paper we looked at last time, they talked about how being able to sense the changes in the environment around you, the physical environment, is a huge part of the sort of psychology of well-being and your sense of connection to your sort of physical landscape. So if everything just kind of looks monotonous and the same and is not interesting in any way, and there's lots of different types of beauty and interesting we can have, and it's not inviting, and there's nothing really to do there, and the public spaces aren't really public use, you're not going to feel connected to the place that you're living in. It's also going to be more likely that it's going to be hard to make deep friendships because you either go to each other's houses or you go out and spend money together. And if you can't get to each other's houses easily, you can see the problem. Or if you don't have money to spend. So, continuing here, so why is it that the human scale is often being forgotten in our cities? To be able to create better communities, we need to continue to ask, where are the people and how are they included in the layout of our streets? Thinking about how buildings invite people to participate on a street level is key for making thriving communities. Building successful places is more than bricks and mortar. It is about keeping the streets accessible and alive. Social Life will be working with Colin Ellard, this is this organization, and the Urban Realities Laboratory to explore the psychology of streets. And they're going to have a running series on walks to map our reactions to built environment as part of the Unusual Suspects Festival. So I'm going to put this article in the chat so you all can check out the sources and the other resources here. And I think that this is really good. I've checked out some of the things and they're very interesting. And there is this article that I also, one of their sources is a conversation, how building architecture can affect emotions that we looked at last time a little bit. And we have this Urban Realities Laboratory, which is doing research on the psychology of urban landscapes. And as you can see here, I clicked on it. It's part of the University of Waterloo. So this is research very likely to be peer-reviewed, sort of rigorous research. So this isn't just like people being like, ooh, modern architecture, ugly. It's actually like looking at What is the evidence that we have? How do people's sense of well-being and health and like long-term health get affected by these things? And let's think about that while we play some Stardew Valley. There's some other things here. I really want to share this link. I know I've shared it. I pointed out to all shared it before, but it's very interesting. And again, like I've mentioned, I really try to get things that are not just sort of American or European academics. Hello, Aradin. And this is looking mostly at human scale living convenience. And I think it's an important thing to think about when we think about, like, do I feel like I can actually do all the things that I need to do in the place that I'm calling my home? Or do I feel like the place that is my home is not actually able to provide me with the things that I need? It can be kind of abstract question, and it's not necessarily all about the urban design or the layout or the like amenities or the resources that are close by. There's a lot of things that go into this, but it's still a worthwhile question. So I'm gonna turn down the brightness of my monitor. It's kind of too bright for me at this point. So we have these questions that we've been asking. And next time, I'm going to read a little bit of this. Obviously, it's 19 pages. I'm not going to read the whole thing out loud. That would be a lot. But I think it's worth sort of looking at m more of this research, right? Like, I do like to have sources that I can cite for all of you. Oh, Krillin, yeah, you say you will never be able to make a public space that feels welcoming to me because no one will ban dogs from cities. That's really unfortunate because I do think that there are enough people who are either afraid of dogs, allergic to dogs, or people who are just not very responsible dog owners that I do think that there should be places that are genuinely dog-free. I get very frustrated because there are just always so many off-leash dogs everywhere. And one, I think it's irresponsible to do that to your own dog. Like, you need to protect them. They don't understand cars or like mean people or whatever. But then also, like, I don't know, they could bite somebody, they could get hurt, they could run up to a dog that's on a leash that's not friendly. It really bothers me. And I think that, you know, like, I want to be able to go to parks sometimes and not be like, how many dogs? Like, I want to sit down and not have to be like, am I going to sit down on dog piss or poo? I want to be able to take my cats outside on, like, I have these little harnesses for them because I want them to get some stimulation and, like, also start to desensitize them to people who aren't me and my partner and just like other stimuli slowly. And we've been working on it. We've been like taking them to the hallway and we have this little like backpack that we put them in and we take them outside a little bit sometimes, just sort of pushing their sort of challenge line. But I can't take them to any parks because there are too many off-leash dogs and like, a dog can kill a cat so fast, and I don't know how my cats would react. And I'm gonna just copy this stupid text of wanna be famous and put it in the auto block. Anyway, this is all to say that I think we should have some places where there are no dogs sometimes, so that people like Krillin can feel comfortable. Okay, so let's put this aside and let's play some Stardew Valley. And let's, as we go through the game, look at sort of like how does the city feel inviting? And also, let's talk about like how is Shane being so terribly failed by everybody? Not everybody, but Marnie is doing nice things for him. But like the situation is just bleh. Yeah, thank you, Barantor. I'm just gonna put that though, that phrase in the automaton. It's like every time. Every time. Every time. All right. No, it's his Barantor band. So, anyway. I'm sorry, Krellen. I want you to actually feel welcome in places. Okay, Steam. I thought Steam was open. Steam has decided it needed to. Update. Always updates. It's fine. It's good to have updated games. I'm working on buying a new computer and researching the parts. I was deciding between these two price points, but then everything, all the parts that I found that I liked are more expensive here by quite a bit. So like the cheaper computer that I was going to get, sorry, I got distracted by chat being like, oh, it gave you a commercial. It's gonna just cost as much as the more expensive one. And the more expensive one is not as marked up. So I'm kind of like, ugh, frustrating decisions. But I'm excited because I'm gonna buy a computer. I'm not gonna stream myself playing Elden Ring. I might. but I'm gonna get one so then I can hopefully have the. Because my laptop's old, right? It's not very nice. So the audio problems, I think, are definitely just on the laptop side. Anyway, I'm excited because hopefully, if we get a new computer, some of these little issues we've had will resolve themselves. And everything, and then we can actually hear the cute music and sound effects of this game without it being all crunchy. And we're gonna do Consent Fest in July. You think people would watch me play Elden Ring? I swear so much. I love the Souls games and the amount of swearing that I do. So people would have to be prepared for me to just be like, yes. Barantor, I have found this laptop. I mean, I have not played around with OBS on a desktop yet, but I have heard that people have. Yeah, new computer's always exciting. Like, my laptop is so old, so even if the computer I get, this new one, is still going to be a desktop, because my laptop still works. It still does the stuff I generally need it to do, so I'm still going to use it, and it's still really convenient to have a portable computer. And I bought this computer 8 years ago now, and it was refurbished when I bought it, and so I got it heavily discounted. And you know what? I'm very excited because even a small upgrade to not a very fancy or new computer will make a huge difference in the games that I can play. I was kind of looking at like what are the minimum specs for Elden Ring. Sometimes I still have it in my head that I'm like, and I'm as as I was the last time I was homeless, and I'm like, I can I actually buy something? And I get very nervous about it, and then I'm like, I can in fact buy something. It's okay, and it's okay to like be doing better. So if you're better off than you were before, it's okay. And if you're not doing better than you were before, it's okay. Okay, Aronimi, so do you think people expect that when it comes to Souls games? Yeah. I mean, like, I love it. I enjoy swearing. My husband doesn't swear. I think I heard him say shit once, and it was for something very serious. And I swear so much, and it's tough when we video chat with his family or like I'm visiting them, because I have to be really thoughtful because they don't like swearing and they think it's for stupid people. And it's like a mark of not thinking and stuff. And I'm like, but I'm from Boston. Respect the culture. Thank you for saying you're on and that I deserve good things. And Veronica, you said, yes, sometimes you have to check yourself because it's easy to fall back into habits and thoughts and worry about that sort of thing with money. It's so much. It's just so hard to be like, okay, but I'm not like that poor. It's fine. Let's see what the fortune. Spirits are somewhat annoyed today, and the weather report. Welcome. It's going to rain all day tomorrow. Okay, that's exciting. Colin, you said if I had money 1 year, that was the year I bought this computer. I also gave away lots of money that year. Yeah, that's the other thing is like once I make more money, like right now I'm doing some still so well that. Oh no, is the chickens just were on top of each other? I thought the chickens were flashing different colors. This one is Krellin. Krellin looks really happy today. Where'd the other chicken go? Oh, there you are. And Silly Millie looks really happy today too. Nice. Oh yes. Yes, look at all of this. I love harvesting these things. It's very exciting. It's very exciting. This game is just so pleasant. Oh, the albacore fishing quest. Thank you. Thank you. I should probably just be doing that right now because I can fish later. I can water later. Let's just get some albacore. Let's do it. Thank you, Tichibron. I forgot about it. Thank you so much for remembering. Yes. So I do want to play Elden Ring. Yeah, maybe I could do that on like Thursdays or Fridays or something. And I'll just be chill. No educational stuff. No interviewing and talking about consent. Just me swearing at my screen. Right time of day for albacore. I think it was in the mornings and then also in the evenings. I could be wrong though. I could be wrong. Let's see. We're gonna get some albacore. I'm like very mesmerized right now by the little bobber just going up and down. So great. Oh, I got a broken CD. Yeah. And I'm not using the training rod. I'm using the bamboo pole. So I'm not blocked from getting fancy fish. Yeah, I like your point, Carolyn. Swearing stream is consent too. Teaches about consent and offense. Yes. Thank you, Dichibron, for checking until 11 a.m. All right. Let's see. Just bobbing there. Wouldn't this be nice though? I haven't gone fishing since I was a high school student, but I really liked it when I was in high school. I would always like usually release them back because the ponds were not usually clean enough to want to eat the fish, but and I did feel bad like just maiming their poor faces, but it is a lovely activity. I think the big best thing though is that you're just like sitting in nature and relaxing. So maybe I don't need to go fishing. Maybe I just need to go sit by a pond somewhere with some friends and like snacks and then just like kind of be quiet and chill there together. Sounds very nice. Yes, okay, I got a hit. Let's see. Oh no, don't get overexcited. Sardine, new record though. Nice. Oh, and it is 11 now, so I'll get one more fish and then go back to watering. The chickens are so cute. Okay, seaweed it is. So cute. I read this thing today that was about the history of chicken farming in the United States. Yeah, record sardine like 5 centimeters exactly, Krellin. And the history of farming in the United States was talking about like, yes, we have bred these like mutant chickens and everything, but they're not the way people think. They're not like uniquely big. It's just we make them get big so fast on their like tiny little adolescent skeletons. But the bigger thing that was in the thing was like why we got there. And it's because the chicken farming used to be like a woman's farming, because it's often common in like labor history that the jobs that men, especially white men or men with a lot of power, don't want to do or put onto women and people of color. And then when they become profitable or lucrative, they push those people out. Like computer programming was that way. It was originally seen as, a sort of mindless woman's job, and now it's, rich software developers kind of thing. And chicken farming was apparently the same. But the traditional chicken farming, where you have these chickens that are actually a lot bigger when fully grown than the modern chickens that we tend to eat, just took more time and required like a lot of expertise in terms of like the chicken sort of health and well-being. And anyway, it was fascinating history. I'm sort of butchering it because, okay, I have three albacore. That is not enough. How do they get so big so fast? It's not, I don't think they give them growth hormones because they do that to cows, but I think with chickens they're not. I think that it's more that they've been sort of selectively bred to be capable of just growing that big that fast, and they've done like gene modifications, and like other such things. I have a magma geode. I've got some good geodes in here, I think. Well, I got two, those and three. Okay, frozen geode. I got some geodes. This is cool. I should go to the blacksmith and upgrade something, but I don't have five copper bars or enough money to upgrade something more. Okay, I've watered everything. I'm gonna go get my eggs. It's an unlucky day today. Little bumming on that one. How many more days do I have? I'll check after I get these. Look at all these eggs. This is so good. And I'm gonna take this hay and I'm gonna put the hay down here, even though they're not gonna eat it for a good long while. Because you just leave the door open and you have this kind of tall grass stuff. It's really great because then you don't have to feed them because they'll just get food that way. It's so nice. And I would really like to upgrade my axe a bit more so that I can really come into this area. I can chop down these pieces of wood and then I can come in here and, sorry, froggy, and actually do growing here and then have more animals and stuff everywhere else. Because remember, we picked the animal specialty because we're not going to end up doing too much farming because we really just don't have the space for it. Let's put down this mixed seed and see what we get. People said some things in chat. Let me see. I think there's a couple of documentaries on like agribusiness and stuff that talk about what happened with the chickens specifically and their way they're made to grow so big. They have very miserable lives. I mean, like I've owned chickens before or like lived with people who own chickens, and you don't have to have them be so miserable, but the farmers with the ones that get bred to like get as big as they can as fast as they can. It's just like imagine you had like 500 pounds of muscle on like a middle schooler's skeleton. Like there would just be it'd be hard to stand if you even could. And De Tribone said, sounds like computer programming as well, originally considered women's work. It was a low-paid job. Exactly. Yeah. And so this happens a lot. All right, I'm gonna plant this mixed seed right there. We'll see what we get. We'll see what we get. And I feel like I need another chest at this point because I've got this chest here for like foodstuffs for when eventually we can get a kitchen and make food things. I'm gonna just sell this gold egg. Wait, unless I need it for the community center. No. Got these eggplants, but I don't have like enough room for anything else. I'm gonna take. Yeah, I just think I need another chest because I don't really have anything yet that I can grow. I mean, I don't have the ability to get a kitchen yet. So let me just make another chest. This will be good. I'll put it over here for foods because I want to be able to cook stuff because making food in this game, if you don't already know it, it's a huge level up. It's just really a huge level up. To being able to do more stuff and accomplish more things because you can just have more energy and you can get all these like cool status effects and bonuses, and it's very fun. I'm gonna put the soggy newspaper in the recycling machine. I thought I had one of those. I don't know where I put it. Okay, what else is going on here? Let's see if there's anything in the cave. Look at my nice apple tree. It's not going to be finished by the end of the season, unfortunately, which is so unfortunate because I was really like hoping We could get some apples to do the thing in the community center quickly, but it doesn't seem like it. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Dichterbahn, is that like it does seem like our ability to cook and to eat. Oh, I got a survival burger. To cook and to eat and to have stuff like that really is part of how we being able to get more calories has just been a huge boon for us. And we needed to have more food. And cooking things really unlocked a lot more nutrition for us. And also just like figuring out farming and all that other stuff. I think it's just from talking. I think every Tuesday when I talk here for a while, my nose just gets like, it's not stuffy so much as it just feels like it's dry. Okay. Let's do a wee bit more fishing. I'm gonna stand here. Let's see. Get into this middle spot. Let's see if we can get some more albacore. Charlie has been trying to convince me that I should go out with this hat on. Like just like out. Yeah, you're right, Arad, and computer was an actual job title, usually in regards to cosmology and astronomy. Cow's Delight, bring Marty one bunch of amaranth. And 2 days to catch seven more albacore. Okay, we'll see if we can do this. Let's try seven more, but I have 2 days, probably counting today. So I probably will not succeed at this. But who knows? Maybe we'll get really lucky tomorrow. We'll get really lucky. It's kind of cute to have these little stones that you can just go stand on. Okay, so let's talk about Shane a little bit, because that's so I put him in the title because I was oh, you think the hat suits me, Aradin? I think that most hats tend to be pretty nice on me, except for baseball caps. They never look good for some reason. I always just look kind of weird. So I think I could probably get away with wearing a cowboy hat outside, but it's like a very flimsy cowboy hat. It's not like a Stetson. Is what they're called, the really fancy ones. Anyway, Dichterbahn, I think it was you who mentioned earlier today in the chat that having something like Alcoholics Anonymous would be really good. And I think that that is actually a really good point and something to start with, which is that, like, are there structures, even outside of something like Alcoholics Anonymous specifically, but Alcoholics Anonymous is something that it has its good points and it has its bad points. And there are things I really like about the structure of how the organization is set up because it's sort of very decentralized. And, there's like this general way of doing things, and there's sort of like the overarching org and the support that it provides for the people who want to set up chapters. But it's very much like there's a lot of flexibility to it. Some of the sort of methodology has its good points and its bad points as well. That is an albacore, and it's the longest one yet. Nice. Okay, and I'm gonna have to eat some seaweed and some grapes and stuff after this. Okay, let's eat a blackberry. Let's see. And okay, but stepping aside from the ways in which I might have critiques of just Alcoholics Anonymous in general. And any of the other similar things like Narcotics Anonymous is the fact that they are in their own way a kind of ritual space, and they are a ritual of sort of confession, right? Like, hello, my name is this, and I'm a whatever, and depending on what the org is based around. And let me make sure. I want to double check. Is this, yeah, that's needed in the community center. So I'm gonna just stop here with eating food for now and go back to the fishing and we'll see. But there it's a kind of ritual, right? It's got this sort of like rhythm to it and how people sort of say what's going on with them. There's the elements of sort of sharing the story of sort of what's going on with you and how you got there and this very like intimate and open and confidential space, right? Like, generally speaking, Consent Academy classes, we use the same kind of model of like, take the learning with you, but leave the stories here. So we say that, like, you know, if I or one of the other educators, I will tell stories, and I always say, like, any story I tell, you can feel free to tell other people, because either it's my own life, I have explicit permission to share it, or it's an amalgamation of a bunch of different stories. And most of the time, it's an amalgamation of a bunch of different stories. And anyway, it's, but we try to protect everybody else's confidentiality. If we're having a class and we're talking about consent and someone wants to be honest about, like, maybe ways in which they don't have the best consent practices, that's, we want that. We want people to feel comfortable to talk openly about these things, so then we can sort of talk about what might be behind the behavior and what we might be able to do differently and provide support. But if people know that someone else is going to go and, like, then repeat the story to other people, they're not going to be as comfortable being honest, even with themselves, right? There's this whole part of, like, if you don't feel safe to be honest with other people, it can have this knock-on effect of feeling unsafe to be honest to yourself. And so having the ability to be honest with other people without fear of judgment or reprisal can be really powerful. And it's not to say that it always has to have the sort of sharing aspect. Like, there are plenty of things that we admit to ourselves that we don't say to other people. Anchovy. but, you know, this is, it can have a benefit. If you feel safe to tell other people, you're going to be feel likely safe to tell yourself, right? That can make a lot of sense. So Alcoholics Anonymous has this sort of ritual, right? Like, the meetings kind of have this rhythm to them, this place where they go, and this way of doing things. And you get, you know, the sponsor, who's a person who's kind of further along in the process than you, who's dedicated, who they're doing some sort of mentoring. They know what it's like. They're not judging. They're there to give support. And that's, like, a very amazing social function, right? There's these ritual aspects. And I bring up the idea of ritual because ritual is very powerful and very transformative. And we can talk about how, oh, this is a difficult fish. I'll talk about ritual in just a second. And maybe next time I'll get some citations about the power of ritual so we can talk about it more in more detail. Okay, is this, yes. Okay, it is an albacore. All right. I'm not going to pass out outside, so I am going to keep track of time, but this is good. Oh, another hit. Yes. Oh my goodness. That is an energetic fish. Ooh. Yes. Oh my goodness. Can I get it? Oh my goodness. Okay. I know it's almost 6 p.m., Cat. No, I didn't get the fish. Okay. I'm going to go a little closer to the home. Let's try to fish here a little bit. My cats are coming to tell me it's almost dinner time. Oh, that was not an explanation point. That was me saying I was sleepy. Okay. I think I can get one or two more casts in, probably. Let's try. Yeah, did you run what you say what you call ritual, I think of as creating a safe container. I mean, the two can be both, but ritual meaning like a thing that kind of has a sequence of behaviors that have special meaning and significance to them that are meant to create some sort of transformation or some sort of other. Oh yeah, level 8 farming! I finally have kegs. Do you know what this means? We're gonna party so hard. I can make a keg, and I should have the ingredients to make a keg, so I'm very excited about that. Very excited about keg making time. Oh yeah, very good. So yeah, but we can define it however we want. But ritual, a lot of research has shown that keg stand, yes. Let's see what the luck is like today, because I gotta also, oh yeah, queen of sauce, tortillas! I love tortillas. In real life. let's see what my luck will be today. Neutral. Well, they're not mildly perturbed. So that's fine. That's fine. That's fine. I got some corn to harvest. Don't want to forget that. And I'm gonna go to fishing. I'm gonna go to fishing. I'll take care of everything else later. We're gonna fish. That is the goal for right now. Get into this middle zone. Okay. And now I can make veggie juice. Yes. Veggie juice. Think the first thing I'll make is pale ale for Pam, because Pam has requested that, and I would like to fulfill her request. Okay, so ritual, right? And there's a ton of research that shows that, like, ritual of any kind, whether they're like religious or cultural or like really official or just habits, have power, right? They've done things where they've like people who like to make coffee in the morning, and they've replaced the coffee slowly with decaf for some people and not for others. And people didn't notice because the ritual of making the coffee was often powerful enough to create the same effect. It's the placebo effect as well. Like, even if you know you're taking a placebo, the ritual of taking a pill and swallowing it can still produce effects. It's not the same. I always like to stress when people talk about things like the power of the mind, that you can't do things like cure cancer or diabetes with the placebo effect. Like, there are limits to these things. The point here is that ritual is really powerful, and it's a very powerful transformative tool that we can have access to. I really like to exploit it in my daily life for the kinds of things I like to do. So I have rituals for like getting into work mode, because I have really bad ADHD, and it can be really hard for me to like really come and arrive and settle into workspaces. So I have certain rituals, or I have things that like I know make it easier for me to concentrate. So like I don't like to wear shoes inside my house because I like to keep my floors clean as much as possible. And oh, what is this? A red snapper. That's cool. Oh, look at this. Look at these geodes and this coal. And that is nice. Nice. Well, I'm not having so much luck here. So I'm gonna go down to the other area for fishing. Where we were yesterday. So I have sneakers that are specifically just indoor sneakers because I think better with shoes on. As silly as that might sound, it's like because I have my whole life done these rituals of putting on shoes is where like going to work or going to school and like being work from home, I have noticed that like I do still just generally think more clearly. And silly Mylethil, you said ritual and creating a container are separate things, but AA has a ritual of creating a container among other things. Yeah, I think so. I think that's a really nice way to put it. So, this has all just kind of been about AA, but we could create those same kinds of structures socially, where we have, like I think. Why do a lot of people like things like going to church outside of religious belief, right? They're a place that is a sort of formalized, structured social interaction, which can be nice because it can reduce feelings of stress or social anxiety. I've had a lot of people who are also swing dancers tell me that they are incredibly shy, incredibly introverted, terrified to actually talk to people. They really liked swing dancing because it had a very clear structure to it, and it was a very clear structured interaction. And like, as long as they just did the thing, it was fine, and a lot of the stress would be gone because it wasn't this sort of very nebulous, unclear, I'm not sure what I'm doing, that kind of thing. Even if they weren't necessarily good at dancing, it was just because it had this structure to it, and because it had these like clear rules and expectations. And it was very interesting when I was on a board for a swing dance nonprofit, and I was really advocating for us to do more safety stuff because I was also the head of the safety committee. And we would have things like there'd be cultural differences. Whoa, a tilapia. The thing looks so cool and so big. Yes, a rod and following routine can really help you get into the right mindset. Absolutely. So I really wanted to create like, how do I want to say this? We'd have cultural differences, like moves that were really commonplace in one part of the country or a different city or a different country would not be practiced very often in Seattle. And sometimes there would be confusion because some of the moves could be weird or like feel uncomfortable to somebody, and they might feel like, oh my goodness, did something bad just happen? Or like, why did the person touch me in this way? Not knowing in this other scene or community, it's completely normal. And I was like, we should have a list of all of the moves that are in Lindy Hop, and we have this category as green light. Like, these are the things that are standard practice within our community. Things that are orange light or yellow light, which is like, they might be, but you should ask for permission because they are things like not everybody likes them and they can make people feel uncomfortable, or like there's a higher risk of injury. Like, there's some moves where you can really hurt somebody's shoulder if you do them poorly. With any of these moves, you could do them, you could hurt someone's shoulder if you do it poorly, but like there's some where the risk is just much, much higher. And a lot of Lindy Hoppers have shoulder injuries because of this. And then other moves were like, this is red light. Like, we don't do these on our social dance floors. They're dangerous. There's only a couple of moves like that, like aerials and lifts. We basically say, like, aerials are for performances and don't lift people off their feet without, just don't do it. Like, it's too risky. You could drop them. And also, like, don't do it. Okay, so then, oh, it's way past. It's way past proper fishing time. I still have one more day, right? Nope, final day. I have to catch five more. Okay. You know what? I'm just gonna fish all day. Just gonna do. Oh, I gotta go pet the chickens. That's the one thing I can't forget. I gotta go pet the chickens. So anyway, they wanted this because people really, there were like these people who had really strong social anxiety, really did not want to cause anybody any discomfort. And they're like, please, 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 could you make this kind of list so I can be more informed? And everybody was just like, you're ridiculous. You're like taking the fun and the mystery out of this dance. And I was just like, oh my gosh, y'all. Like, we have people asking for this who have said that it'll make them feel safer and more comfortable to dance because they'll know what's expected of them. And anyway, I'm digressing. The other point here being, I should plant these wheat seeds. Yeah, the mystery of, yeah, I don't know. You advocate for things that are very like, just, I want people to be comfortable and like happy and not feel harmed or alienated, and you know, like know that they belong and they're not doing anything wrong, and people will lose their minds. Is really will get upset, and you're just like, okay, I don't understand. It's fine. I need to make a second chest. Too many things. I think, can I put this in here? No. Recycling bin. Okay, I'm just gonna throw this newspaper out. My inventory's kind of full. Special bobber. Yeah, let's go and try to get a special bobber from Willie. But there are things to forage. Gotta get the forageables. Anyway, I wanted people to feel more comfortable. But the point still comes back to like knowing your place within a community, knowing where you fit, knowing what's expected of you. That creates a huge benefit, right? Because you can feel more comfortable with, you know, stating boundaries, knowing what's normal, then also knowing when something that's abnormal happens, that it's abnormal, right? Like, I've done trainings at places like Microsoft where people who are like the heads of the intern programs to be like, hey, you're gonna get a bunch of 19-year-old interns who've never had a job before, who have probably no context for what is and isn't normal within a workplace, and you need to be extra careful because you can ask them to do things and they're not gonna know that they can say no, for example, because they've never had a job before and they might be terrified of saying no to their boss when they could actually do it. Oh yay, Willie is here. Oh, and it's a cutscene. Willie says, come in and make yourself at home. Not that energetic though. I'm looking around, looking around. Aye, that's the good stuff there. The fish go crazy for it. Just make sure you wash your hands good after dipping them in those juices. The aroma has been known to linger for up to 7 weeks, miss. And I jump away from it. So, you've been catching a lot of fish? Yes, actually. Oh, I got a heart from Willie. Lady after me own heart. You can always count on a lady who fishes. That's what my old pappy used to say, at least. Ha ha. Well, keep going. Keep it going. If you can catch every fish in these waters, I've got a special prize waiting for ye. That's cute. Everything okay? Aye, well, business has been tough lately. It all started about the same time that old community center fell into ruin. Me fish just don't sell like they used to. I've been working double time just to make ends meet. So this is a great example of the things we're talking about. No time for my own projects. Ah, the misery. The community center will help because it provides other resources and brings in more people, and it's going to help with so many things. And I'm very excited for the day when we bring back the community center. No time for my own projects, but if things pick back up around here, I might have time to show you something. Hehehe, yep, she's back there, an old friend that's seen better days. Someday, miss, you'll see what I mean. Okay, let me talk. Can I put a bobber? I don't know if I can put a bobber on these. I could buy the fiberglass rod. I could buy the fiberglass rod because then I could put a bobber on it. Or I could put bait. Yeah, I could put bait on it because I can't use a bobber. Why not? Why not? We got the fiberglass rod. And then I can put bait on it. Let's get a bunch of bait. Okay. Okay. But I'm gonna sell him. Not the albacore, don't worry. But I'm gonna sell him something so I have some room in my inventory. Okay. Let's go. Oh, wait. Oh, he had trout soup, but it's kind of late. Oh, wait. No. I still have time. Okay. I'm gonna move this guy here, this pole here, pick this up, put the bait on there. I'm gonna. Trout soup, I think, will raise my fishing skill. And so, yeah, plus one fishing. So I can buy two trout soup. With all my money, I'm gonna do it because I'm feeling impulsive and it's fine. Okay, let's fish with our fiberglass rod in these medium waters. I know it's not time for the tuna to come back out yet, the albacore. Let's just give a couple of casts and see how this goes. Yeah. Look at this. Red snapper. Yeah. How much time do I have on this? 4 minutes. Okay. I probably should have gone home before I drank the soup, but that's fine. That's fine. Oh yeah, fishing is fun. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Yes, okay. Yeah, I think this is the most energy I've ever had this late in the day. You're absolutely right. Okay, so the point I was talking about earlier, ritual, having a space where you can sort of share these things, having structured community interactions, which is one of the things a lot of people like about going to church. And if you're going to say like a Catholic church with confession, having a place where you can like just safely share things about yourself and your troubles without fear of being judged for it, and like having an idea of a path forward, I think is something that's really alluring to a lot of people because, you know, you confess to a priest and then he tells you, you know, say this many Hail Marys and this many Our Fathers and you're good. And then it's like you have a path forward and that works for some people. It doesn't work for others. But there's still this idea of like you can have a path forward, which is really and a place to safe to talk about what's going on with you in your life, and a place that's got like structured, you know, predictable social interactions that are not necessarily stressful. Like these are some things that Shane probably could be offered and could benefit from. There is a church here. It's in Pierre's store, and I know Pierre is kind of like, I don't know what's up with it. I didn't put it there. It was here when I moved here. But I think that it's still one of these ideas of like, that's probably offering people stuff. Now, Shane doesn't feel welcome there, doesn't get the benefits from it. This wouldn't be everything. You know, like, I'm definitely not saying that all people got to do is pray about it and everything's fine. Definitely not. Oh, no. But there is this idea of some things that can be offered in these spaces are incredibly powerful and can make a huge difference. So, is there hope for Shane? Well, does he feel he has the right to access those things if they exist? Right? This is a huge thing. If he's already got tons of shame and self-hatred, which we know he does, he probably doesn't feel he has the right to actually access those things. And if he does access them, he probably feels some kind of bad about it. I have too many things in my inventory. Oh no. Okay. I'm gonna eat the seaweed. I don't want to run back because I'm like, oh, I gotta catch the albacore. It's so little time and so much to do. Okay. And then I will eat this plum. And should be good. Should be good to keep fishing. Fish, fish, fish. Okay. So does Shane feel like he has access to those things? Is there a therapist in this city? As far as I can tell, no. And that's probably makes a big difference, right? There is some recreation, but not very much, right? The community center shut down, and there is the library and there is the museum. There is like, you know, nature stuff to do, and there are the, you know, the festivals, but in terms of other types of recreation, there's not a lot. And there's not a lot that like you could maybe go to a different town. But, you know, recreation really brings people together. You know, having gardens and outdoor spaces is a big thing for sure. Absolutely right, Arad. And prayer is important, but it was never meant to replace action or be done without connection to action. Yeah. And like, you know, there's not recreation. So, you know, even if you have a good job, which we know Shane doesn't, he works at Joja Mart, and like it's probably not paying him very well, probably doesn't give him very good benefits, certainly not enough to likely sort of get out on his own and really get things started. So, I mean, in a lot of ways, I feel very sad for Jane. Because, like, you know, you might have to go to another town to do some recreation stuff, right? Like, there's no movie theater or bowling alley or, you know, escape rooms or just like other. Whoa, I got an eel. That's exciting. But now my inventory is full again. Okay, I'm gonna get rid of the seaweed and get rid of the trash. I don't need this muscle. I hate having to make these decisions, but it can't be helped. Am I gonna get the Am I gonna get a couple things left? I hope I get another albacore. I got myself the better rod. I got the soup going. Oh, I ran out of the soup, but come on. I'm hoping this is an albacore. Yes. Okay, how many more do I need? Four more. I don't think I'm gonna make it. Oh, rough, rough. So, if you've not seen after you restore the community center, there's some you can cover your ears. I'm gonna put my hand up, I'm gonna put it back down. Spoilers will be over. Okay. So the spoilers are that, oh no, I missed the fish. The spoilers are after you get rid of Joji Mart and you complete the second quests, you get a movie theater. And you can you can invite people to go to the movies with you, right? Because okay, so I'm putting my hand back down. So recreation, if the recreation that are social, social connecting kind of recreation is all in another place, it also makes it harder. I did use my bait. I do have the bait on the doobly doop. I forget what this word is. Fishing rod. I might have used it up, but I shouldn't have. It could be harder, right? Because not everybody's going to be able to take the time to travel to the next city or have the money to get there or have a car or if the bus isn't working. And, so it's going to be harder to build those friendships. And a community center is really great because remember, we want to talk about recreation and things to do that are social outside of the home that are not always involving spending money. And this is good. This town has a lot going for it. It's got a lot of public space. There's a lot of outdoorsy recreation things that you can do, though a lot of them require money or equipment, like if you want to go into the mines or you want to go, oh my God, just completely missed that. The last two things were definitely albacore, but I'm not gonna meet this quest. It's okay, but I really wanted to get it. But I definitely, have probably leveled up my fishing quite a bit and really made it. I bought a new pole, so this is also better. And it's not. Oh my gosh. Was a terrible wimpy cast. Okay. Let's see. Broken CD. I don't need you. Oh. Come on, albacore, come on. I can definitely pass out on my farm tonight because I have so little money, it doesn't matter. Come on, albacore. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. I missed that. I missed it. I don't think there's any way unless I got really, really, really lucky, but nope, soggy newspaper. Okay, it's fine. Okay, it's fine. I mean, I don't regret this. I think we made a lot of good progress. Oh my goodness, too excited with my clicks. Oh no! I had a chest in there and everything. Boop. But I would have liked to complete this quest. It's fine. Come on, come on. Albacore, albacore. No, it's not an eel. Well, I mean, I'm catching cool stuff. Maybe you took a wrong turn at Albuquerque. Yeah, probably. Probably. This isn't even my farm. I've just wandered somewhere else. Twilight Zone or something. Oh my goodness. Oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no. I was so close. Come back. An eel. Yes, it is Stardew Valley and Elden Ring. Make me want to swear. Okay, so I got a diamond. Very exciting. I got some more bait, which is nice. I still have 15. What? What? I'm throwing away this muzzle. It's fine. Diamond is nice, though. Okay. Crit Witch, hello! Welcome. I pulled you out of your lurk. Okay. Come on, come on. I'm gonna just fish till I pass out, but we'll see. We'll see. Technically, the day ended though, so like, you know, because it's after midnight. Oh my God, no, stop bouncing off the top. No. That was so close. Oh my goodness, why is this so hard? Ugh. It's another eel. What is happening? What is happening? Hi. What is happening? Why am I getting so many eels? Come on. I have 10 minutes left. I can get you 4 albacore. No, and I passed out in the ocean. I'm gonna have wet pants. Fishing level 6. Welp, welp. Yeah, it's the shrieking mules. You're absolutely right. Well, I level up in fishing, so it's definitely worth it, but still. Okay, so let's talk about our lovely shiny boy some more. Because I, like I've mentioned before, just want everybody to be happy. Displeased spirits. Well, then, okay. What is the weather going to be tomorrow? Rain all day tomorrow. But displeased spirits, huh? Look at the leaves falling. It's so lovely. Okay, Ariel. Luckily, I found you last night. You were unconscious, and someone was searching your pockets. I have no idea how much money they took. They took one money. And they ran away as soon as I approached. Be more careful. You know, Linus, you're a real buddy. Blackberry season. Bushes are full of them. I lost my basket. Luckily, I know where the basket is. Because I played before, not because I stole it. Oh yeah, let me put this on the rod. Nope. Come on. Come on. I believe in you. There we go. There we go. Okay, I'm gonna put my old bamboo pole in here. I gotta go over here. Yeah, good thing I had spent all that money. Yeah, it made a positive impact. Okay, I'm actually gonna make some copper bars because that would be nice. All right, what else am I gonna do? I'm gonna make some copper bars. Come on. I'm gonna sell my jam, my melon jelly. Look, I got more maple syrup. That's exciting. Okay. Maple syrup goes in there. Gonna go over here. I'm gonna sell this. I'm gonna sell my gold corn because I might as well. And I'm gonna sell my gold albacore because I might as well. And these 4 gold eels because they'll get me money and that is nice. Put anything in here? No. Let's go down to this chest. What can go in there? Those, and then the rest of my foods can go in here. I've filled up my fishy thing too. That can go in there for now. That's fine. That's fine. Okay, so this is pretty good because now I will have 5 copper bars when we're done, which is nice. We might as well make some iron bars. Get to some progress there. And then I should pet the chickens, water the crops, harvest the cranberries. Heck yeah. Look at the chickens. They're so cute. Where's the other one? Where are you at? What are you doing, little buddy? Are you in the building? Whoa, so many eggs. So many eggs. Yeah. At least I didn't cement galoshes. You're right, silly Millie. That is good. Cause yeah. Hey Kettlestick. How's it going? Where is silly Millie chicken? Oh yeah, look at these blackberries. Yes. Where did the chicken go? What are you doing? Where are you hiding? Where are you hiding? Where are you hiding? In the grass by the tree. No, don't eat the egg. Which grass by which tree? Did everyone help me? If you don't reveal your secrets. Watch the grass for movement. Oh yeah, okay, I see him now. Thank you. All right, let's get these cranberries. This is exciting. And hopefully I can make a keg today. Thank you, both of you. Don't eat the cranberries. I need that for cranberry beer. I'm excited. Well, cranberry wine. All right, look at all of this. Look at all of this. All righty, I'm gonna sell these gold star cranberries because, and the silver ones. No, I'm gonna save those. I'm gonna save them. I'm gonna save them, even though I'm very tempted to just sell them all because I want early money rather than late money, but I need to respect my future self's desires to have more money. Anyway, what do I need to make? I can probably make two kegs. I have two oak resin. I forget what else I need to make the kegs. Oh, that's it. I got it all. Copper bars. Oh, yes. I'll need to get and an iron bar. I can make one and then I can get other bars. I thought I was getting ahead on this. Oh, you're hunting worms, silly Millie. Yeah, that makes sense. Let me just put these things away for now. Okay, I'm gonna make a second keg, which I'm very excited about because the keg stuff is just like, it's just good, exciting stuff. I'm gonna put it up here. I guess I can't. Oh wait, maybe I was not close enough to it. No. Okay, it looks like here is good. Put these two kegs here. And I'm just gonna immediately start making cranberry wine because that's gonna be very lucrative. And I'm gonna make another chest just to put next to here for things that are specifically. Yeah, it is very JoJo Mart of me. Capitalism, man, capitalism. It's a heck of a drug. Okay. When do I make mayonnaise presses? Do I have that yet? I feel like I should. Yes, I should be able to make a mayonnaise press. Oh, I need an earth crystal. Do I have any earth crystals? I do. I can make a mayonnaise press. What else did I need again? Stone and a copper bar. Okay. Stone and a copper bar. And let's make a mayonnaise press because then I can do more stuff with these eggs, which is also nice. And I'm gonna put the mayonnaise press. This is very, very just like whatever organization for now, but I'm gonna put some eggs up here because then I'm gonna make mayonnaise pretty regularly now it seems. Look at that. Look at this. Look at this. Oh wait, you're Maudine. Yeah, nice. Okay, I still have to water my crops, but I feel like I've gotten a lot of good stuff done today already, which is very exciting. All right, yep, and I'm gonna continue to water my crops with salt water because it works, apparently. And I gotta give my puppy water in a water bowl. Okay. Look at this. Look at this. Look at these crops go. I should buy some more seeds because it's only the 8th. I don't have any money today, but I will likely have some money tomorrow. And it's not Wednesday, so tomorrow, so piers won't be closed. Joya Mart. You pronounce it Joya Mart. Huh. I don't know. Probably other people do too. I would not have guessed to pronounce it that way. That was That was bad aim. No, again, bad aim. Why? Why? Every time, why? Okay. Well, I'm gonna just continue my inefficiency. So what could we do for Shane? So does Shane have resources that he needs? Does he have a job that gives him a meaningful place within his community and opportunities beyond just work until he dies? No. Does he have recreation opportunities that are not are not solo or like expensive? I mean, they have the bar, the saloon, and it's being in places where it's always involving food or drink. Like, I think that things like cafe culture in Europe is great because it does perform this really important social function in that it gives people places outside of the home to interact where you can linger for long periods of time without having to spend a ton of money. Like in France, I would go and spend like just 75 cents on a cup of coffee and then coffee, and then sit there literally all day. Not all day, but like for several hours and just read a book. Oh my God, the mayonnaise is already done. It's that fast. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Do y'all know what this means? I got trapped in the trees. That's what it means. Anyways, we're gonna have money. That's very exciting. Very exciting. I'm gonna sell this mayonnaise because I'm gonna be able to buy more seeds, and it's gonna be great. It's gonna be great. And then I have more money. Are there any gold things? I need these gold corns. Okay. I need the gold corns. So I gotta be careful to not sell any more gold corns. I'm gonna take these chicken eggs. Oh, I need this eggplant. Oh, I need the. Let me look at this. Let me look at this. Oh, I could have used that orange that I ate, but that's fine. And a pomegranate. I can definitely get an orange and a pomegranate in the cave sometime. Honey, cherry cheese, truffle oil. Okay, 5 gold corn and 5 gold pumpkins. Gotta definitely make sure I've got pumpkins here. And I need a pumpkin, a yam. Okay. Yes. Yeah, next I can make starfruit wine, and that will be very exciting. So I need a large egg, duck egg, milks. Oh man, I can't wait to get cows. That'll be so exciting. Can't do it from here. Nope. Okay, 5 gold corn. And do I have pumpkins in here? I better. I hope I have pumpkins. Okay. I need a pathway th through everything. I put these eggs in there. I watered everything. This is exciting. Look at this progress. Look at this progress. Do I have any more seeds that are fall seeds that I can plant? Some tree seeds. I got some mixed seeds. Yeah, let's plant some mixed seeds. Those are always fun. There's always like, you're like, what am I gonna get? What's the surprise? And luckily, I've got a bunch of places that I watered that didn't need to be watered. So I already did the labor. Excellent. Okay, now let's go get Linus's. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner is a cute name for those cows. Yeah, I have to give Marnie the amaranth, but it's not ready to harvest yet. Here's the bucket. Look at that. I'm so excited. Hopefully, Linus is not too suspicious because I found it literally right away. But anyway, it's blackberry time. It's always a good time. In Seattle, there are tons of wild blackberries that kind of grow everywhere. And it's really nice because in fall, and you're like walking through some of these pathways that are far away from cars and everything, there's just delicious blackberries. And you can just munch them just right there. Let's see if there are any more blackberries around. I gotta go sit on. I gotta go do it. I gotta do it. I gotta sit on the little dude. Yes. I wish you could rock back and forth. That would be so fun. But you can't. Okay. Okay, let's move on. Let's move on. Yes, blackberries. Let's go give Linus's bucket and basket thing, because that'll make him very happy. All right, so what else? What else could we do? What else does Shane need? Do we think that a person needs in general? Let's say hi to Robin. Madu likes gems. She uses them in her inventions. Cool. Thank you for telling me you had a better hit on your daughter. Oh, and I see Linus. I'm gonna give him a hazelnut too, because he likes the forageables from everything I've read. Okay, hey, come back here. No, I want to give it to him. No, I don't want to eat it. Boom. Oh, my basket, that means a lot. Okay, yeah, but now here, this is a great gift. Thank you. Can I say hello? Okay, you're good. All right, sweet, 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 sweet. Let's say hello to Demetrius. During this time of year, I divert my attentions to fungi. Yeah, I mean, fungi are pretty amazing. Fungi are pretty amazing. Oh yeah, there's another hazelnut. Woo! Oh, and I see a mushroom. This is a good foraging day. Look at this. We're just rolling in the forageables. Okay, so think about yourself and your own community and the things that you need in order to feel good. Like, and I mean feel good in like a fundamental level. Not just to have lots of like stuff to buy or restaurants to eat at, but like, and I'm not also assuming that everybody wants like the same kinds of friendships, or that like friendships are even the priority for most people. But just the basic elements, tend to be the same, and we don't all have access to it. What did you say, Aradin? One of my cousins married into a family that had a farm and a bunch of cows, and apparently that was the names given to three of them. Well, yes, I agree with Critwitch that does keep things in perspective. Look at all of this though. I got 16 blackberries. Let's go down to the lake and see what other blackberries. Or there's more. There's more. Yes. What else we can get? This is amazing. Amazing. So if you were in Shane's position, what would you need in order to sort of feel better about your life? I think I could easily say for me, the first thing would be not a dehumanizing job. The job I had, my main sort of job that I had for several years before I became the co-director of Consent Academy, my job does really not pay me very much, and it's technically part-time because I'm splitting it with my co-director, even though it's definitely more than part-time's worth of work. It's like two full-time jobs a week. And I'm not complaining because this job gives me a sense of meaning. And that's one of the things that can be different. It's not about having lots of money. And part of it, it's because I'm lucky. I'm living in a place where the cost of living is much lower and the social safety net is much better. And so I can, prioritize the whole like meaningful work. And it's also like, I have a technically, I think I can qualify for Social Security disability insurance because I've got enough health problems that impact my ability to have a normie job. And I'm lucky that my current, that Consent Academy as a job is like really flexible and disability aware and good about those things. I'm not going to just keep bragging about my employer. But anyway, like having a job that's not dehumanizing, the job I had before this, I worked for them for many, many, many years. I started in like 2014, and they paid basically just above minimum wage, but you were an independent contractor. So, like, it was rough because you were on the hook for self-employment taxes and stuff, even though they decided everything. And they, never give raises. And so I never made more money than from when I started. And I started in 2014. And so if it doesn't, Meaningful work at Krillin would be a lot, which is why chickens. So if inflation is like 3% a year and I worked there and I never, you can see I basically was just getting pay cuts every year, right? And also just like there were a lot of things that were dehumanizing. They would always do like these like silent evaluations where they would evaluate, oh, hey, it's Shane. Speak of the devil. Shane, I don't know you. Why are you talking to me? Fair. 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 Let's see what's in the trash. One of the other things I do want to say though is like I don't want to just sit here and like say I know what's best for Shane and here's what he needs and this is be make his life better. And like I've played enough of this game to know that he does end up saying that he doesn't like his dependence on alcohol and the ways it makes him behave and he wants to change things. But I would not argue that for everybody who uses alcohol a lot. You know, because there are lots of people where it's not terribly impactful for them, and they, or even if it is, they want that. They want to live that life. And it, to the extent that they're not hurting a lot of other people, you are completely allowed to make those decisions for yourself. You do not have to, quote unquote, live the standard definition of a good life. Yeah. I definitely, I'm not. Oh, you're right. The Amaranth is ready to go. So let's cite that and bring that to Marnie in the morning. Can't go knocking on her door at 1:20 in the morning and be like, "Hey, I got your cow stuff." Okay, people put some stuff in chat. Let me check out what y'all said. Silly Mylithiel, you said when I worked as a software developer, every job bar one, and even one the mostly felt meaningless. I made a lot of money, making it hard to stop. But it was soul stealing because I saw no benefit to real people. It was completely unrewarding to me. Right. I mean, this is what I think they talk about with like the like golden chains or something where you're like, I'm trapped because of how much money I'm making, even though this job is terrible. And that's not a great position to be in. Okay. Selling. Look at that. I think this is the most I made in a single day so far in this game. Jam and some fishies. This is great. Thanks again to Gibran for saying I should make save the melons for melon jam. Excellent. Excellent. I'm gonna play one more day, even though we're a little past time, because I'm vibing with all of you. It's pretty good. It's pretty good. Mildly perturbed spirits. Why? Why? Look at these sunflowers. Okay. I can't go to Pierre's right away because he's not open yet. I'm gonna replant the sunflowers. I like that the sunflowers are like kind of self-replicating. Okay, Willie says, come by the shop and check out the new rod I'm selling. They're the best money can buy, and you can customize them. I just bought a new rod from you, my dude. What? What? Yeah, bonus Stardew Valley time. Ariel, how are you doing? I've enclosed some instructions on how to make one of my favorite fish recipes. I learned how to make sashimi from Linus. That's so exciting. What a sweet person. Oh, and more mail. Mary Lewis, okay. Dear Ariel, 1 week from today, we are holding the Stardew Valley Fair in the town square. It's the biggest event of the year, drawing people from all across the country to our humble town. If you like, you can just Grange display for the event. Bring up to 9 items that best. I just sold all my gold stuff, so that's good. Golden handcuffs. Yeah, great. Okay, well, I'm gonna save more gold star things. Yeah, I got some gold sunflowers. And I got a bunch of gold forageables. That's fine. Look at this 44 blackberries. That is amazing. What a haul. Oh, yeah, and I got more mayonnaise. Oh, and there's more blackberries up here. Nice mayonnaise. I'm so excited. Wait, I only need one egg right now. I only need one egg. All right, let's go pet the chickens. Oh my goodness, I'm trapped by the trees again. Again. I'm gonna put the mayonnaise in here. Let's go say hi to the chickens. And then I gotta make sure I buy some more pumpkin seeds. Look at how big they're getting. It's so cute. Oh, is that a large egg? It is a large egg. Yes. I gotta save this large egg. Or the community center. Very exciting. Let's go see if Marnie's up yet so I can give her 440 blackberries baked in a pie. Yeah. I gotta give her, let's see if she's, oh, there's more blackberries over here. Yes. Yeah, time to cut some of those trees down for sure. Oh my goodness, more blackberries. I have too many trees on this farm. I can't go anywhere. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Okay. Yep. I'm gonna just grow a forest. This isn't the forest farm. That's a different one. Why are there so many trees? I don't have my axe on me though. All right. Let's see. Let's give Marnie this good stuff. Oh my goodness, more blackberries. What am I gonna do with myself? I got errands to run, but there are too many blackberries everywhere. I just need them. I just need them. So, thinking of ourselves and how we could create a better sense of community. Oh, yes, I'm gonna give you this. Oh, the amaranth I asked for. Thank you so much. My cows are gonna love this. Yeah, we're gonna be friends. Can I get my shorts? Here you look like you're so soaked, you poor thing. Let me in the room. I need the mare shorts. They're right there. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Pierre should be open, so let's go. Yeah, why is Marnie working on Tuesday? What's going on? Hey, Mary, just go back to her house and get your shorts. They're right there. Taking a break? No, I'm busy. I hope the river doesn't overflow. Me too. That would be rough. Oh my goodness, I saw more blackberries. I gotta go get them. It's so nice when you can get tons of these berries because it makes a big difference to like energy levels, especially before you can get this. The cooking kitchen place. Okay. What's the quest here? I never remember to check for people's birthdays. Oh my goodness. Trying to keep the art of fishing alive. I'll pay 150 gold to any fishing enthusiast who catches three chub. Good luck, Willie. You get to keep the fish. I will accept this quest because I've been doing a lot more fishing. Seeds for sale. Yeah, I know. That's why I'm here. All right. Let's get pumpkins. 13 days. I will have just enough time. Let's plant 15 of them. And it's good enough. Good enough. Okay, let's go plant. Let's go plant these. Beautiful pumpkin seeds. And we're going to save the rest of that money. Yes. Oh, look at this hazelnut. I like the hazelnuts. It's pretty great. I like the roast hazelnut recipe. So yeah, just think about it because I like to talk about these topics because I want to normalize these discussions and this kind of reflection on like how does the way we set up a community affect our consent? How does the way we set up a community set up like how well we're gonna live and how we're gonna feel about our lives? And I think that Stardew Valley is really great for this discussion because it just offers a lot of good topics and examples of how things can go wrong, how things can go right. Let's take this to the community center today. Anna's eggplant. Any of these other things need to go to the community center? Let's check it out. Yes, thank you to Tibron. I was going to ask if anyone remembered Chubb could be found. I'll take these to the community. Oh, I don't have 5 gold coin yet. Community center. And then. Oh, wild plum. Okay. And then hazelnut. Oh, pomegranate. I do have one. Nice. I will take these things to the community center and then I will go to the mountain lake and try to catch some chubs. Okay. I already got The eggplants are good. Orange, nice. Oh, red snapper I need. Okay. I'm gonna just go to all my boxes and see what I need for the community center. Let's see, let's see, let's see. All right, that looks good. That looks good. I'm excited to do a big community center haul. It's always very exciting to put things into the community center. I got more bait here. What am I doing? Oh, tilapia. I need a tilapia. Okay, I'm gonna take this bait with me and put it on my rod. Let's do that. Yes. Bug, yeah, make more bait with the bug guts. Absolutely. Good idea. I don't know if I have the recipe for it yet, because I think I have to get it from Linus eventually. I have a purple geode. What now? Oh yeah. Okay. Oh, and I need a sunflower. All right. Nice. Okay. Oh yeah, the decor item. No, do not eat this orange. I will be so sad if you eat this orange. Okay, just one more check through. Anything here? I'm gonna put this guy back. Nope, okay. Off to the community center we go. Let's do it. Community center time. I'm so excited. Okay. Here we are. Ugh. Look at them, they're so cute. Okay. Not that one. Not that one. Ocean fish. Red snapper and tilapia. Nice. And I need a tuna still. Okay. Okay. And then lake fish, largemouth bass. Bass? And sturgeon. Oh, I sold all those eels and I could have done that. What am I doing? What am I doing? Well, I can get more eels. I can get more eels. Dye bundle. Okay, nice. Got the sunflower. Great. Chef's bundle. Not yet. I do definitely have 10 wheat and 10 hay, but I'm not really gonna do it until I got eggs. Are y'all saying? Let me see what's up. Crit Witch, outside of libraries and a few parks, I don't really use community places. You've got me thinking about local community center. Last week, haven't been though. Yeah, I agree, Rodden. COVID has been tough in regards to that. And Crit Witch, you also say that, and I suppose the local game shop where I play games would be considered a community hub. Yeah, I mean, it really can, right? Places that bring people together and make people feel connected and give people places just to like be outside of the home. Oh my goodness. I don't have that much money. Why are you hanging out over there if I don't have that much money? What's going on here? What is there anything I can put here? No, I just need a fire quartz. A fire quartz. That'll be so nice when I get it. Yeah, I mean, like, I talk a big game about all these things, but I don't leave my house very often. Even before COVID, I wouldn't leave it that often. But I think about things like swing dance. Like, I love swing dancing. And it was basically impossible to do it without paying a bunch of money because you always had to basically do it in certain types of venues, and it just costs money to go to them versus having the ability to just like meet up with people in a community space that was free, and then we could just dance together and enjoy it. It was difficult. Do I have any yams? Did I plant any yams? I should go. Okay, I'm gonna the one more room because I definitely have more things that I can add because I know. Fall foraging bundle. Yeah, here we go. Finish this guy. That's exciting. Bundle complete. What did I get? Oh my goodness, 30 falsies. I gotta go plant those and make sure I got some yams. And then, yes, look at them go. It's so cute. But I still think about like what would encourage me to feel comfortable leaving the house more in general. I do like to go sit outside in public spaces and read books and things like that. That's very nice. Especially if no one's gonna come and bother me, which is not always a guarantee. Let's just get 5 yam seeds and let's go plant these bad boys. Make some more fertilizer. I definitely know I have more sap, so we can make more fertilizer. And I think about like what else would encourage me? Like I like to be outside for sure, but I'm also incredibly pale. And I sunburn very easily. And so I like to have more places that are shaded and more places where I feel I can linger would really help. And places where I just don't have to spend money. Like that's a big thing is like, and I, or where it's less expensive, but it's still beautiful and comfortable and nice. Like, and I think that these things should be available to people regardless of like, you know, your socioeconomic status. It would be really nice if there were just more places where we could go and just hang out in a pleasant, comfortable place without any expectation of spending money, without any pressure to do anything like that, and can just be there. And there are things to do. Or like, you know, obviously if you're getting things like food and drink, you know, it makes sense why money is always going to be involved. But it doesn't have to be exorbitantly expensive. It doesn't have to be something that feels unwelcoming. Like, I know that if I'm in a part of a town and everything on the menus that I walk past is like just very expensive, you know, and I'm not even talking like really posh places that are like very high end and like, you know, luxury meant to be expensive, right? Like, I'm not talking about that. I just mean like in general, it's expensive, like more than I can afford to pay for a meal. I generally think, okay, this part of the city isn't for me. Like, I'm more or less not gonna stay here. I'm not supposed to be here, whatever. And I don't think I'm the only kind of person who feels that way. And I think that also, like, thinking about what are the other things that would make me feel like I belonged in a place, you know, obviously language barriers can be one. And I'm both on the side of, like, I don't wanna just be an entitled American and just think, oh, everyone speaks English, so I don't have to learn German. I'm working on it. But also just like, you know, being accommodating to the fact that it's not always easy to just pick up a language immediately. And like, I can definitely feel my brain struggle to keep the languages I do speak straight at this point because I kind of speak too many. My brain gets kind of muddled sometimes, and I just don't remember the word for something in any language, or I can only remember it in, like, you know, the Finnish I could speak as a child or something that I don't even really remember that well anymore. And I just sit there and I feel my brain be sad. But anyway, you know, things that would feel accessible in those ways. Yeah. It's nice when there are like public events that are happening that encourage you to leave the house as well, that are fun and exciting and kind of novel and cool. Things that make you feel like, yeah, okay, it's I'm gonna get out of the house for this. That sounds nice. All right, let me put some forageable things away. I should double check first that there isn't a regular hazelnut. That's the problem with having multiple chests or anything is like making sure you're not just accidentally duplicating everything in like a bunch of different chests. Difficult to manage that. Let me put this in the house. Because you're right, it is the standing geode is a cool decoration. All right, you guys have been saying interesting things in chat, so let me read out what you're talking about. Barontor, you said I saw some folks that hung up hammocks in a park near here and were reading, and it definitely gave me some ideas. That sounds lovely. Crit Witch, yeah, it hasn't helped my hermiting tendencies. I've been pushing myself to go do things. Yeah, I really relate. Barantor, same. Crit Witch, Crit Witch, Aradin. That's is an interesting question. I think right now it would be mostly seeing people not being idiots in regards to COVID, which sadly isn't something in my control. Yeah, I mean, for sure, a pandemic is kind of the very like intense situation that really can make a lot of people feel unwelcome and unsafe very fast. To Chibrun, I'm also pushing myself to go out these days after some pretty major hermiting during the pandemic. Aradin, I think the fact that I am most comfortable in front of my computer and it is what helps me handle and manage anxiety also makes it hard for me to even want to go out right now. The main thing would be it would be nice to feel comfortable going to see a movie if I wanted. Yeah, I mean, I think that that's a good example, right? Like, I definitely, as I mentioned before, I'm not trying to say that, like, the right way for everyone to live is to do as such. Like, no. I'm just saying, like, I want people to have more options because having more options means that you have more opportunities to say yes and or no to things rather than just basically being like, well, here's the thing, and I gotta do it, and I don't have a choice, right? Because I want people to have choices. And the more options we have, and the more place, like the things that make it so it's also safe to try something new or experiment a little or go out and say, like, see, do you want this? Or like, be welcomed while you're trying something new. Like, these all are things that will increase a person's agency, which will increase their ability to decide what they want to do for with their life and what they do and don't want to have happen to them. And, you know, I think that those are really important considerations, right? Because again, I'm not trying to say that, like, here's the one way everybody should behave and live. I'm saying that the more options people have, the better things are. And I'm mostly interested in, can we give people other options? And if people want to access those options but are struggling, right? Like, I might want to go outside, but I can have some pretty bad agoraphobia at times. And there have been times where I'm like, just can't leave my house because I'm pretty sure, like, if I go outside, something terrible is going to happen and I just need to stay home. But I don't want that to be my life. Like, you know, like, that's not how I want to have my experience of the world. And, you know, I've had access to things like subsidized mental health care. Because I've gotten very lucky in Seattle, Washington State provided a lot of good social services in those senses. But the point being, like, offering people options and giving them tools to help them make use of the options when they want to, right? Giving them the ability to have more yeses and more nos is a huge part of giving people more power and more control over their lives. And to me, this is what I'm really concerned about a lot of the time is like, does Shane, for example, actually have that many opportunities to say yes or to say no to things? I think one of the few things he's probably got the most control over is things like choosing to drink or not to drink. Oh no, I got myself sluggish and I have no food to rescue me. That's fine. That's fine. But does he have as much agency, right? Does he actually have as much power to make decisions about his life? And there could be times where it is true that someone has, technically has these things, but if you don't feel in a very like intrinsic kind of way that you actually have these opportunities and you actually have access to these things and you're not feeling tortured with the idea that you don't deserve something, then you don't actually have access to them. Does that make sense? Like, you actually have to feel that you have access to these things. It's the same as saying no. People will be like, well, the person could have said no to me, and so they can't say that this wasn't right. And I'm like, but if they didn't feel that they could say no, then they couldn't actually. And so if Shane doesn't feel like he gets a lot of yeses and nos in his life, he doesn't actually have them. So even if technically he could, you know, just wake up and decide to not drink. I mean, it's not actually possible if you have an addiction, but you know, it's if he doesn't have access to those resources and if he doesn't feel he can access them, then he doesn't have access to them. So anyway, I'm rambling. Not rambling. Ranting? Ranting. Okay. Look at this. Look at this. Two mayonnaises. It's amazing. Amazing. Two mayonnaises. Anyway, that was gonna be my last day. I've enjoyed chilling with all of you. Thanks for hanging out for the extra half hour today. I really enjoyed it. Oh, I have a new quest. Let me see. Cow's Delight. Oh yeah, cool. I'm gonna have to redo that next time I log in, but that's fine. I forgot to go do the chub fishing. Oh well. Yeah, so absent of choices, which that's a thing I think a lot of people, I think it's pretty common to not think about it because we're so used to living in a world that's very non-consensual. Because in Consent Academy, we base our model of consent off of the idea of autonomy, that you have the right to decide what happens to your body, your mind, your spirit, your information. And like my autonomy ends where someone else's begins and where they overlap, we need to negotiate. But we're used to living in a world that denies a lot of our autonomy. We're used to being in a lot of really non-consensual situations that they don't even register for us a lot of the time. And so a lot of the time, people will end up using drugs and alcohol or other types of escapism as a way to help them sort of deal with and just survive the ways in which they don't have choices. And when you think about it, I've mentioned it before, Zizek, the philosopher. I don't really like everything he definitely don't like everything he says, don't like a lot of the things he says, but I do like his definition of violence. And he says violence is the removal of choice through force or threat of force. And so we can talk about institutional violence and like systemic violence as sort of like not having access to choices about what's best for you, and then being kind of ground down over time by these things. And exactly, Aradon, sometimes people make poor, quote unquote, poor choices, or maybe even objectively poor choices, if I can say that exists, because those are sometimes the only choices they feel they have. Or sometimes, like if you have very little control over your life, you're going to try to get control where you can have it. And sometimes the only places you really have control are not things that you actually want for yourself in the long run, for example. So, anyway, there is hope for Shane. There's hope for all of us if we help build a more consensual world where we have more access to more resources that we need, where we have more ways to interact with each other, more sources of meaning. Just, anyway. Thank you all for joining me today. If you aren't following, we are doing a follower goal, hoping to get to 200. So please consider giving us a follow. It's free. Check us out on the interwebs. We have a website with upcoming classes. I think website, if I do this and will that work? Nope. Oh yeah, here we go. That was just slow. And then we have social media. You can check us out there too. We have a lot of free classes, and we also always have sliding scale prices. This weekend, we are going to be interviewing on Sunday a group called Pleasurable. They are a disability advocacy org that does work around consent and sexuality and disability, especially normalizing the fact that people, no matter how disabled or what they look like, are still sexual beings and have a right to sexual pleasure and pleasure from their own bodies, and that it's not weird or gross or something that people shouldn't talk about. And we're going to be interviewing them. And then after that, we have our free support group of Consent for Women. So last weekend was our Consent for Men. This weekend we have Consent for Women. So check out our schedule if you're interested in coming to that. Anyone who identifies as a woman can come. You don't have to sort of be on hormones or passing or whatever. Like there's no, we don't gatekeep womanhood. And so everyone's welcome. Who feels comfortable with being called a woman? We also have a non-binary one that is in a few weeks. And what else do we have coming up? Oh, the Seattle Erotic Art Festival is also coming up. If you are in the Seattle area, I highly recommend checking it out. It is the par my parent organization, the Pan Eros Foundation, that puts it on. And it's very cool. It's got lots of live performances and shows, and they have like really just cool art and really interesting things. And you can also check out on the VOD the stream that I did with my boss, Sophia, where we talked about the Seattle Erotic Art Festival and sort of philosophy behind it and things like consent and art and sort of the purpose of art. And anyway, check that out. Thank you all for joining me today. It's been really lovely. You definitely helped distract me from the fact that my stomach is being a butt. And I will talk to you all later.